So the first section of this lab is the basic UI user interface layout. This is what we will implement. So a background image with a bar, a top bar image also, and an animated image. In this picture, you only see it from the side, but it's a moving logo, moving ST logo. Before we start with the first part of this lab, we have to extract the input files that are needed and input the prepared project that we made for this video. So normally, along with this video, you should have the following folder structure. So a folder containing all the slide set of the graphic workshop, including the one we are browsing right now, which is this one, the number 5. And you have also 3 zip files. The first one contains the original demos and the one that is flashed on the board out of the box. You can easily reflash it using the bat files, the batch file which is here in the binary folder. You just double unzip the entire content and double click on this file. It will unplug your board also, of course, and it will automatically flash the original demo, which looks like that. So it's a set of all the demos for each graphic libraries. So there is a Steamwind, there is also TouchFX and Embedded Wizard. The other zip files are the 2 files for the entire lab. The first one is we will unzip this one. So if we follow the slide, this is the first step. You have to unzip this prepared project. So this prepared project is not really prepared in the sense that you can get it from the TouchFX designer, but we prepared it because there is, as we will see, there is a specific Quad SPI setting that is not Octo SPI, sorry, settings that are not functional on all boards. It seems that we, in the current application template, so when I'm talking about application template, I mean the examples that are provided by the TouchFX Designer tool for all the ST development kit boards. So when you open the TouchFX Designer, we will see in a few minutes, the first screen is the selection of an application template. And to select it, you have to select the board on which you want to work. And once you select the board and create the project, it will download. So this is from the internet. You do not have all the examples installed when you install the TouchFX Designer. So it downloads the proper files to your computer, and it will be almost exactly the content of this zip file, except for a few settings that we have to tune in order to for this workshop to happen in the sense that we had several attendees at each session, and we wanted everyone to be able to work. So with the default settings, some boards were either freezing or having a black screen. So if you see this kind of issues on your board, it means that maybe you did not apply, or maybe the settings of the Octo SPI are wrong, and we will see where it is exactly in the code for you to update. It's in the slide set, it's described also. So we will extract first these 2 folders in this folder 2020 STGFX workshop. And the other zip file is the modified files. So we already implemented all the 5 steps of the lab into the source code, but within a specific defines. So the code is disabled, and we will enable it by defining step by step each compilation flags. So for the moment, we will not use this file, this zip file. We will only start using it at step 3. So what did we unzip? We unzip two folders. So this one is the one that is normally created by the TouchFX designer, but this one is modified regarding the OctoSPI settings. And we unzipped also the assets, so all the images, the input images that we will use during this demo. And starting by this animated logo. So you can see, in fact, animated logo means several steps of an animation of the logo. And then we can also see the background image and all the buttons that we will use in either pressed state or release state. We will see that during the lab. And then we can open the TouchGFX project. So the TouchGFX project, if we go back at the root of the folder, so the root folder will always be the 2020 SCGFXWS. And in this folder, we go in our project. And in this project, let's describe it. So what is inside? First, you have all the initialization code of the board. This is the regular code that is outputted by the Cubemx tool. It contains the made.c, so it's the entry point of the application, and the initialization of all the peripherals that have been defined in the Cubemx tool, or by yourself if you do not use the Cubemx tool. Then you have the driver folder that contains the high-level abstraction layer drivers. These are high-level interfaces that have been defined for specific features of our IPs, and especially the BSP folder that contains all the drivers, the low-level drivers that are needed to interact with the devices that are connected to the MCUs. You can see that in this folder. There are many, many, many components. This includes a touch panel, or these are for external flash memories. For example, these are display controller drivers. We will not use, of course, all these components, but these are the components that are included in the H7 1.7 cube firmware for the so all. These are all the components that are included in all the H7 discovery or evaluation kits. We will see in the CubeID that only three of them are used. In fact, two of them are used. It's the touch panel driver and the external flash driver. And these are the specific drivers for the H7B3i. It's not really drivers, it's more a set of defines for each component to initialize them quickly. In fact, since we are providing these devices with our state development kit, we also provide a way to initialize them quickly. And these are can be, of course, some starting point for developing your own driver when you choose another display or another external RAM or another touch panel, for example. Then you have the IDEs folder containing the project of each IDEs. This one is for IR, the MDK ARM is for KIL, and the STM32 CubeID for the CubeID. There are present the three of them. Maybe in the future only one will be present, the STM32 CubeID, because you have to understand that the IDE you choose is defined in the Cubemx project you use. So by default, it's set to CubeID. You can change it, and in this case, normally the corresponding project should be created. So by default, here we have selected the CubeID project that is defined in this file. So the IOC file is the Cubemx project. So in this file, we have the information that STM32 CubeID should be used, and MDK ARM and EWARM, in fact, should not be there. Okay, they are there for the moment. It's the first version of the plugin. Do not be surprised if in the next release of the application templates, only one folder remains, but you are free, of course, to define another IDE in the Cubemix project, and then the corresponding IDE project folder will be created. The GCC is the makefile based GCC toolchain that is used to build the target binary from the TouchFX designer. So you can see here that you have also a scatter file and a startup assembly code. So this makefile will you can use it if you want. You can modify it even, but normally it is used transparently by the designer. When you press, we will see in the designer, when you press the run target button, it will first build the code using this makefile. Then the middleware contains the external or internal middleware libraries, such as the FreeRTOS library and the TouchFX Framework library. And finally, the TouchFX folder that contains the file that will reopen in a second, so the .tjfx project file, and all the file that corresponds to the TouchFX project. This one is a specific file that may also disappear once this one exists. It is the file that is created when you start from scratch your application on your custom board from Cubemix. So you use Cubemix to create you create a project using Cubemix, selecting the correct MCU. Then you set up your configuration in terms of IPs. You enable the TouchFX plugin in the Cubemix tool and generate the code. And the first, in terms of designer, the first file that will be created is this .part file. And this .part file contains the mandatory information needed by the TouchFX designer tool to create a project with the correct screen definition, the correct color format definition. So once you double click on this file, the TouchFX .touchfx file will be created, and this will be the project file for your TouchFX designer. So before opening it, let's have a look at the folder hierarchy of this TouchFX project. These are internal entry point for the TouchFX application. The most important to look at are in fact the asset folder. The asset folder contains all the assets of the application. By assets, we mean the input true type fonts that you will use in your application, but also the input images. So you can see the images, not yet, because the project is empty for the moment, but the input images that we will add in our project will be located in this folder, in a PNG file or other format, but in the raw input format. And it will also contain, update this Excel file containing all the translation and all the textual values of your graphical user interface. The build folder will contain the object created when building the target using the GCC makefile. The build folder will contain the output of the build launched from the TouchFX designer. So for the moment, it's empty. And the generated folder will contain all the files corresponding to what you defined in the TouchFX designer. All these files in the generated folder are read-only and should not be modified directly by yourself. Normally, it can happen, but note that if you modify them and regenerate the code from the TouchFX designer, they will be overwritten. So the usual way to do that is to generate your basic user interface in the TouchFX designer and then use the subclasses that use these base classes. So for example, in the GUI generated, it will contain the basic, for example, the screen one. So this is the one screen that is defined already in the application. It's the default screen that is defined. And this screen one view base will be the base class containing all the initialization that have been made in the TouchGFX designer. So if you add a widget from the designer, or if you add a background image, it will be the initialization will be done in this class. And if you want to add a custom widget that is not available in the designer, that you define yourself, then you will use a subclass of this class, which is automatically defined here. So the ScreenRunView class inherits from the ScreenRunViewBase class, and so it can either extend what is done in the ScreenRunViewBase class or override what is done, so to make your custom behavior in your application. Note also that you have a simulator here. So the simulator means that you can either launch the simulator from the TouchGFX designer. It will use another Makefile based toolchain to build the code for the PC platform, for the Windows platform. But you can also use what is provided here. It's the Visual Studio. Okay, it's not created yet because we did not generate the code from the tool yet. We will see just after, but it proposes a Visual Studio solution that can be used to debug also the simulator. If you want only to work on your graphical user interface logic, not the interaction with the system, because you will only work on run it on Windows, you can debug your layout, your logic using the Visual Studio. While when you run only the simulator from the designer, you are not able to do some debugging, some step-by-step execution, for example. So with this Visual Studio project, you will be able to do that. And the most important point is the interface with the system. So this target folder contains the generated file. So these are generated by the CubeMX, not by the designer, when you set up the TouchGFX plugin in the CubeMX. We will come to that during the lab to see what is done exactly. So let's now open the TouchGFX Designer project, which is located in the TouchGFX folder. So double clicking on it should normally open directly the TouchGFX Designer, because the .tgfx and .part files are associated with the program. And we open it on an empty layout. Not really empty, because we can see that there is one screen, one default screen that is defined.